Today on Across the Fence, we have a very special show for you. In fact, one of the most special I've had the fortune to be part of. Hi, I'm Leonard Perry with University of Vermont Extension. As you can see, today we're in Fenway Park in Boston to visit with the head groundskeeper, David Meller, to find out just how such professional turf fields are maintained so beautifully, with some tips for managing home lawns properly as well. We'll also find out just how those intricate mowing patterns are created on this and other fields, and how you can even try this at home. Thanks so much, David, for spending a few minutes today to talk with us about these topics.
Absolutely. Welcome. Thanks for having me.
And I guess the first question is, how long have you been here at Fenway, and over your time here, what are some of the changes you've seen in the park?
Well, this is my 13th season with the Red Sox, 29th year in the majors, and I grew up a Red Sox fanatic, and so having the honor to be at Fenway Park is a dream for me. And, you know, we renovated the field in 2004. Ownership invested in a new field. Before that, the last time the major renovation was done on the field was 1934. And back then, they didn't have subsurface drainage that was really done well. So they had a big crown to the field. It's kind of like a turtle's back. So the water would roll off of the field. And in 2004, we excavated the old field out, put drain tiles every 15 feet on center, then 3 inches of washed pea stone, then 9 inches of sand. And we're able to make the field much flatter. The infield's flat, center field's flat, then there's a slight grade in left field and right field. And this helps with safety and playability, but then also with drainage, enables us to play games much sooner in rain. And then also the field recovers well from extra events. You know, the grass is only as good as what's below in the root system. You know, the roots grow in the pores of the soil, not in the soil. So having the sand, or you think of marbles underneath there, it enables to have space in the sand for the roots to really grab hold.
Well, that's what I was going to ask you. It seems like with a good house, you need a good foundation. Obviously, you're not just putting sod down here on anything. You've got a really good foundation under this. So it's deceiving what you see, and that, I guess that's one reason it drains so well, when you see those downpours and where'd the water go.
We're very fortunate to have a great drainage system. And then we also aerify. You know, we pull cores, we use solid tines to open up and get that air into the soil, as well as the nutrients down there. But that air really helps the field to grow well, but then it also opens it up for extra drainage.
And how often do you have to do that?
Well, we core twice a year, once in the spring and once in the fall, as far as the entire field. And then about every 2 weeks, we will poke holes using metal tines to just help varying the depth from, you know, 1.5 inches to 5 inches deep, 6 inches deep, and vary that routine so we're not getting a hard pan at any consistent depth from only aerifying at a certain depth.
Well, the other question I was wondering about is, what varieties of turf grass are you using here?
Well, we bring in our sod from New Jersey, and it starts out as 100% bluegrass. Then we'll seed into it with perennial rye, because we can get the ryegrass to come up in, you know, 7 to 10 days, where the bluegrass is going to take 14 to 21. And so we try to stay on top of it, so we have seed coming up at various stages, especially in the high wear areas. And, you know, it may come to the point where if we have a wet homestand, an area may get beat up enough that we'll resod. And once again, we bring that sod in from down by New Jersey, because it's grown in a sandy soil that's 93% sand, so we don't get an interface between the different types of sod with our root zone.
I think about sod being kind of rolled out like a carpet, and if you got a game coming on here, how do you keep that from shifting? How do you get it established so quickly?
Well, our rolls come in 4 feet wide, and they're about 30 to 35 feet long, and they're 1.25 inches thick, so they're so heavy they just don't move. We roll it to make it snug, and then we walk every seam, and we'll top dress those just to make sure everything's nice and tight.
Okay. So, and one of the things, I know a lot of society, a lot of home gardeners are going to more environmentally friendly practices. I assume some of your practices here at Fenway have too over the years.
Absolutely. We certainly use integrated pest management to diagnose whatever the situation is before we just do anything with chemicals, certainly. If we can mechanically fix a situation through maintenance practices, we will. You know, we haven't used an herbicide here in, I believe, 13 years. We will use fertilizers, both organic and synthetic, and fungicides, but we use them very, very carefully. You know, I think all too often a homeowner thinks a little bit's good, a lot must be better. And it's really important important that they follow the instructions on the bag, they're careful how they spread, that they're not getting some on the driveway that then washes down the storm sewer. And, you know, it's better to use a little bit at a time of anything than too much, because you're going to hurt your lawn and it's going to be too weak, but more importantly, you're going to hurt the environment.
And I think you told me an interesting story before about how you learned the beauty of weeds and lawns about your own home lawn.
When I was in college, I thought, when I get my first lawn, it's going to be like a pool table, not a grass blade out of place and no weeds. Then I had two daughters who taught me through their eyes how beautiful a dandelion bouquet was for their mom and for each other. And they would love when the seed heads would go to the big puffballs, they would chase each other around the yard and call them blow flowers. And we would sit for hours making clover necklaces and looking for four-leaf clovers. So a weed is classified as any undesirable plant that's out of place. So the most beautiful rose bush on Fenway's field would be considered a weed. So I really learned all about tolerance. And, you know, I don't use herbicides. If I don't need to at my house, I'll mechanically remove it or use corn gluten. There's organic ways you can deal with weeds too. But it's all about tolerance. And I remember when my daughter turned 5, we had a birthday party where 25 kids came. And as I was greeting the first car, the second parents got out of their car. I went to say hello, and the father wasn't there. And I said, "Didn't I see your husband here? I want to say hi." And the mother said, "Oh, yes, he's walking around your yard to see if he can find a weed." And I would have been happy to show him where we would sit for hours looking for four-leaf clovers.
I think it's both a great perspective, plus it shows the value of, as you've been mentioning, a good culture. And going to the culture, I see in practice a lot of action going on here. There's a way games here. You'd think you'd be on vacation, right, while the team's away, but not. You're doing patterns and all. What are some of your regular practices here at Fenway?
Well, I'm fortunate to have an incredible staff. You know, we stress attention to detail. I think the little things separate us from others. And just like, you know, when someone turns on their TV or walks to their seat, we have one opportunity to make a first impression. Homeowners the same way. When someone drives by their home lawn, you have one opportunity to make that first impression. So a beautiful, healthy, green lawn is all about creating memories. And it can be the perfect backdrop for a beautiful landscape, a local wiffle ball game, you know, soccer game, a picnic. And it's all about having fun. But it's important to get the whole family involved. You know, some of my favorite patterns that we've done are some that my daughters have been involved in or created themselves. You know, any mower will make a pattern in the grass with its tires and its blades. You know, a light stripes mowed away from you and a dark stripes mowed toward you. Kind of like if you ran your fingers across shag carpet or you vacuumed, you'd see that nap change. And so we stress straight lines when it calls for, and that pattern's kind of like, you know, farmers now use GPS, but years ago they would pick a point in the distance and plant toward it. We'll do the same thing. We'll pick a wall pad or a seat, or we may put an irrigation flag down and mow toward it. But I think patterns are only limited by your imagination. You know,
notice that with you know, some of the people making the patterns, your staff, they aren't, you know, have fancy equipment as far as GPS or strings. They're just got a good eyeball, I guess.
Absolutely. You know, and anybody can make a pattern. It's, you know, if you make a mistake, you just go back the line before and start over. You know, in my first book, Picture Perfect, there's step-by-step instructions there how someone could build their own homemade roller from a used lawnmower handle that they could pick up at the local repair shop and some PVC pipe that then they fill with concrete and make end caps out of plywood, and they can roll their own patterns in that way also.
So just a homeowner can do it as well. They don't need a fancy equipment like you have.
You don't have to have the fancy golf course type equipment. You know, there's some great homeowner version mowers. Simplicity, MFG.com has lawn and garden tractors that do great job. Most mower decks are hooked up under the front of the seat and under the back on light riding garden mowers. And when they hit a bump, they'll scalp. Where Simplicity is hooked up under the front of the seat, and the whole back of the roll deck has full width rollers. So it follows the contours of your lawn, but then those rollers really help put in that stripe, so you can mow like the majors with that too.
Well, you do more than just stripes. I know in the past I've seen the Red Sox logos and many other things. How do you actually, I guess you probably design them on paper, how do you translate that into the field?
Well, you know, patterns can be, you know, traditional checkerboard lines. They can be something festive like the Sox logo. If we're going to put in a unique logo, the B or something, we'll measure it out, and we may even string it out. And then we'll use the mowers with rollers. We have some hand rollers that we use that both we've built ourselves, just like in the book Picture Perfect, or we've used carpenters, linoleum rollers that can be done. And we'll also use water pressure. You know, we don't use much water to do patterns, one, because we don't want to waste it, but then also we don't want to have anything, even though the field drains great, we don't want to make anything wet that could create that. But a homeowner, as long as you're not under a water restriction, if you mow your lawn away from you and transport around so everything's kind of mowed away, it's light, you can take a hose and use water pressure, and you could write happy birthday. You know, you could do all sorts of patterns in your own lawn with water pressure, especially if you're cutting at a higher height. You know, homeowners around here should be mowing 2.5 to 3.5 inches high, and having that extra length of the grass blade really helps give you an opportunity to put in more of a pattern. We mow at 1 1/8 inches for playability. When the team's in town, we mow every day so that today it plays just like it did yesterday. But when the team's on the road, we mow about every 3 days. But homeowners, you know, need to follow what's called the 1/3 rule. So they're never cutting off more than 1/3 of the grass blade at a time. So in the spring, certainly you may mow twice a week, but that way you're not going out and baling hay and leaving a lot of clippings out there. We recycle our clippings into the field. We don't catch our clippings, usually unless it's around the edge. Unless we've given an opportunity to grow for 3 days, we may catch a few clippings, but we try to recycle those back into the lawn.
So basically the key sounds like frequent mowing, mowing at the right height. You don't need to bag those clippings, haul them away, just use that to recycle the nutrients. Again, part of that more environmental approach.
Absolutely, that's very true. And then you're not taking clippings to the recycling bin and filling up the landfill.
Well, I think that's a couple great tips, and I know you've got many more. In another book you've written, you mentioned the one, Picture Perfect, about the patterns, but you've also written the book on the home lawns. So hopefully viewers can get a chance to look at that, and I look forward to doing that too. But I guess in the last minute here or so, I've always been curious. You've got a lot of events other than ball games here, from ice rinks in the wintertime to concerts here in the summertime. That must really play havoc with this beautiful turf grass. How do you deal with some of those really tough situations?
Well, I'm very fortunate to have the support throughout the organization and have the opportunity to have input on planning an event, protecting the event. We try to make sure the grass goes into an event healthy, and a healthy, actively growing grass can handle a lot of wear and tear. And if it gets to the point with hot weather, wet weather, that we get damage, you know, we have the sod on call ready to bring in. And so things are thought through very well, and I'm fortunate to have incredible support, not only from my own staff, but throughout the organization.
Well, great. Well, this has been great. Some good tips about Fenway in general and your background. How did you come to be, get this job at Fenway? Did you just luck into it? Is it?
Well, I grew up, you know, my dream was to make it to the majors as a player. And a month after I got out of high school, I was hit by a car. And I walked on crutches for 2.5 years, walked with a cane for 10 months, missed my opportunity to play college ball and hopefully get drafted. And my family said, reach for your dreams, find a career you love to do, because so many people don't like their job. And I thought, gosh, what do I like to do? I grew up taking care of people's lawns. Science was a subject I enjoyed in school, and I loved baseball. So I thought, somebody has to be a groundskeeper. And so I reached out to the three leaders in the industry at that time, Mr. Joe Mooney here in Boston, Roger Bossard with the White Sox, and George Tomlin with the Royals, and said, you know, how do I get my foot in the door? And I was planning on going to Ohio State at the time. They said, get your education, get as much experience as you can. And my brother lived in Milwaukee at the time and said, if I could get a job with the Brewers, I could live with him to save money. And so that was 29 years ago. And fortunately, in the fall of 2000, Mr. Joe Mooney called and said, David, I'm thinking about retiring, but I'll only retire if you replace me. And that, I mean, I was so honored. Right. And I grew up a Sox fanatic. I certainly knew who Mr. Mooney was, and to have the honor to follow in his footsteps at historic Fenway Park was a dream. And and they made an offer that my family and I couldn't refuse, and it's been a dream ever since.
Well, this is just great to learn a bit about this and your background, and just appreciate so much a few minutes of your time and the Red Sox management for this chance to visit with you here today.
Well, thank you. Welcome. I'm glad you guys came down, and we look forward to seeing you again.
Well, hopefully we can be back. And thank you for watching today on Across the Fence for University of Vermont Extension. I'm Leonard Perry.
For a video copy of today's program, call toll-free 1-888-ATF-3430. Across the Fence is brought to you as a public service by University of Vermont Extension and WCAX-TV.